So I'll start with just some biographical background. Tom and I have been working together for 20 years. I think we signed up, was it two moons?
It was Dewey.
It was Dewey, 94. And we've done probably 8 or 9 books together, I've lost count. And as you probably know, Tom is a rather versatile man of letters. I mean, he writes fiction, he writes essays, he writes reviews, he also writes extended nonfiction, most of which I've published at least one of all those sorts. And I think the thing that I, thinking about Tom and me over the years, the one thing that has really sort of struck me recently is sort of, at least I see it this way, Tom may see it differently, Tom has made a remarkable change in the last two books. I always thought of him as a writer of historical fiction. He had a knack for picking events at the periphery of American history. So the book that he did before he came to Pantheon was a book about the other couple in the theater box at the Ford Theater. The Dewey Defeats Truman book, which was the first book I worked on, was about the upset. It took place in a small Michigan town. It was about the upset victory there and how it upstaged a number of people's lives in that town. He did a book about the discovery of the two moons of Mars. He did a book about book loosely based on, was it Vanity Fair in the 1920s?
Really GQ of the 1920s. Propelled back.
And so there were always these books that sort of took these oblique glances at things that were happening just outside the center stage. And for years I've been harassing Tom because one of his great obsessions is with Richard Nixon. And I've been harassing Tom for years to write a nonfiction book about Richard Nixon because he's, to both of us, a figure of tremendous complexity and intrigue. And Tom kept on gently deflecting me until a few years ago he finally said to me, "I think I've figured this out. I think I can give you your book on Nixon." And it was the novel Watergate. And what was sort of extraordinary about this was a book that Tom was writing I no longer thought of it as historical fiction because he lived through this period. He was not doing the secondary research that he did for a lot of his earlier books, and he was writing about a period that he participated in, at least observed, and I immediately noticed in that there was a fluency in his description, in his evocation, that was, I found, completely different than what he was doing with the historical fiction. And the book we're here tonight continues that strain. It's about Reagan and Reykjavik. I mean, it's about a period of 14 months in Reagan's second term when, as Tom puts it, everything is falling apart. Everything is going to hell in the handbasket. But I think what's remarkable about both these books is that they're more populated by historical figures than they are by fictional figures, which is a huge shift for you. I mean,
yes.
I mean,
I think that's very true. I mean, a book like Two Moons. There are a lot of politicians in Two Moons. Chiefly, this is on, right?
Yeah.
Rest of this, okay. Chiefly Roscoe Conley, but it's a fictional couple who drive, you know, the narrative, and that was a book that proceeded really more from my interest in a period and a place than any particular narrative line. Even the main event in the book, the discovery of these two moons of Mars, was a kind of hook for all of the other things I wanted to do. I mean, I think that what Dan is saying, I think, is very instructive about the way some editors, good editors, the way he works with writers. Dan is a wonderful line editor. I still overwrite. I still take far too long to describe things. Narrative is the thing that I learned to write last in both fiction and nonfiction. I started life as an essayist, as a critic. In this, my goddess and mentor, Mary McCarthy, was the same. She had begun life writing nonfiction, writing criticism. Once in the 30s, when she needed money, she was going to write a mystery novel to make some money. She was going to do a pot boiler, and she realized she had to give it up after the third chapter because she said, I didn't have a corpse. By the third chapter, because she was too busy describing everything and commenting on everything and judging everything. And my early fiction, I mean, that was the tendency that I had to fight, certainly. And and then I did fall into this pattern of writing about these peripheral figures. And I was very scared of taking on trying to inhabit the actual principles. Henry and Clara, I mean, I made a decision right away not to have Lincoln himself say or do very much, because whenever I attempted it, whenever I tried to write a line of dialogue for Lincoln, he sounded like Raymond Massey. See the dry ice swirling, you know, around the edges of the Lincoln Memorial. And I thought, no, better to stick with these figures with whom a reader can identify. That is one thing that I think obscure characters, fictional or non-fictional, I mean, non-fictional like Henry and Clara, peripheral but real, they nevertheless offer possibilities of identification that the big figures can offer. I mean, who can identify with Lincoln? I mean, they would send you to an asylum if you said you did. But I do think I needed to be pushed in a direction that I that a more frankly political direction. I loved politics from the moment I was cognizant of anything. I mean, my first really sustained political memory is the Kennedy Nixon election in 1960. We were passionately for Nixon in my household. We were terrible.
Catholic castle.
I went to school with a Nixon button to the fourth grade every day. And Nixon was the figure who overarched my entire life. And there was something about his defeat. I remember crying in the kitchen the night he lost to Kennedy. And I remember going out to the kitchen to talk to my father because I was too embarrassed. I didn't want my sister, who was all of 11, to see me crying over Nixon. So I butched it up until I got to the kitchen and started crying with my father. And I also was absolutely certain Nixon was going to win, which is stayed with me that I'm a terrible prognosticator of all events, political and otherwise. But there was this, I think, identification with him and with losing, which was very peculiar to me because I was this, if ever there was this little Irish striver, if ever there was somebody eager to please adults, if there ever there was an A student, that was me. But I was also a big ham, and in the elementary school debates, I remember in two successive years during the debate on the Civil War, I played Jefferson Davis, and during the debate on the Revolution, I played King George the Third. And I was following Nixon all the time for his comeback, and then he becomes president. His presidency coincides almost exactly with the time I'm in college. And he, of course, let me down in all kinds of ways. And I had fierce arguments with my father about him, who was absolutely always on message for Nixon to the bitter end. And but something was there that really stayed with me. And the night that Nixon died here in New York in 1994, he died in New York Hospital. Bill, my partner and I, we had come back from hearing music at the Cafe Carlyle, and you can could see why I wouldn't have a corpse by chapter 3. Digressing. We came back from hearing this music at the Cafe Carla, and we were back in the apartment, and the news said that Richard Nixon had died that night. And I burst into sobs. I was racked, doubled over. And Bill said, I'm going to make a drink. I don't really mean, like, I'm going to let this play out. And of course, my feelings about Nixon were wildly mixed, wildly ambivalent. And that, to me, in terms of literary obsession, I don't know if it's true of political obsession and adherence to a cause or a viewpoint, whatever, but I think wild ambivalence is one of the best things you can have about any literary subject. I mean, I remember being taught in college that it was the great poets were always the ones who were absolutely radically split. Emily Dickinson, you know, in the morning she was a Calvinist, and in the afternoon her transcendental side broke out. You know, I taste the liquor never brewed. And Yeats, you know, we've got to blow up the post office, but I really want to have a 6-course dinner at Lady Gregory's. John Donne, I mean, the greatest poet to me, some of the greatest, with the exception, I guess, of Hopkins, greatest poetic experiences I've ever had. This cerebral religious poetry that comes out of the Dean of St. Paul. At the same time, he's, you know, the great rake of English poetry. I mean, there was even a book, I'll bet you had to read it in graduate school, J.B. Leishman's book, Jack and the Doctor, about Donne. The two sides of Jack the Rake and, you know, the Doctor. That, to me, is essential. You don't want a novelist who's reverential, but you want a novelist who is involved, who's all in. And that, Dan and I were talking about that, we talked about this while I was writing the book. The earliest decision I made in writing about Reagan was I was not going to inhabit him from the inside out. It was too spooky, too mysterious. He was too much, Gene Kirkpatrick character says Reagan is smoke in this. And so, I don't know what it says about my moral character. I never felt any difficulty being Richard Nixon, you know, inhabiting him and writing about him in the close third person. But Dan did push me further into the real life figures, further into politics. And in some ways, what he was doing was resuscitating something that was in me for a long time. The first fiction I ever wrote, I'm not even sure you know this, when I was 14 years old, entirely in longhand, in my big pen, I wrote 100 longhand pages of a novel I called Impeachment. This was 1965. It was about a fictional president who got impeached. And the only person who ever read it was my father, who had endless patience. And he read every page of it, we would talk about it, whatever, and I can't remember at what point I abandoned it. But clearly something in me wanted to go to this territory.
But I mean, this interests me because some of the things that I find so powerful about what I'm thinking of these two political novels is that, you know, we live in, you know, when we think about politics in our culture and how it's reported, how it's discussed, it's ideological divisiveness, you know, that there are these huge divides between Republicans and Democrats. What has impressed me from the start in these two books is how you really see politics as drama. Mm-hmm. And you really are fascinated by the participants and the actors in this drama, and you're sort of willing to give them this huge stage in which they can display as many of their qualities as possible, and you're not passing judgment on any of that. Mm-hmm. You're displaying them. I mean, this is, to me, what makes these books so compelling, is that there isn't, you're not drawing some didactic lesson, you're sort of saying, right, this is both a human comedy and a human tragedy, and I'm gonna present them in all of their complexity, Nixon being the most complex, but it's true of even the lesser characters.
Well, I think one of the things that...
yes?
Should I take it out of my pocket? Here we go.
Okay, and all right here?
All right, yes.
You know, Gore Vidal, certainly did not know him to the extent that I knew somebody like Mary, but I knew him somewhat. I edited him at GQ. He was very nice to me. I never wanted to get to know him any better than I did because I was terrified that, you know, at a certain point, he will turn on me the way he did on everybody. But he was extremely nice to me. I asked him advice about my novels, about Henry and Clara. He was the one who told me to put the assassination at the beginning. He said, I would start with the bang bang. It's the hack solution. He said, but that's how these things get to be the hack solution. It worked. And I took that to heart. And, but I think, and Vidal, of course, I think did more than anybody to revive historical fiction in the United States. Historical fiction was a kind of white elephant genre. If you look at it, say, between the World Wars and even somewhat after, costume drama, you know, Anthony Adverse, it was the books you always found.
Reader's Digest.
Yeah, at that summer house in Maine, you know, that these big, big clunkers. And he revived it and put wit into the books. The other thing, though, that he put into his books, which I've never been inclined to put into mine, is he put a kind of thesis about America. He had a view of America as this wayward empire, had become wayward by becoming an empire. And he was very concerned with the allegorical functions of historical fiction. He wanted you to draw parallels between 1876 and 1976, whatever. That has never been a part of historical fiction or political fiction. For me, I really did want to show, to use a phrase from a writer I don't much like, Graham Greene, the human factor, because I believe a lot of history depends on accident. I mean, I wrote a little nonfiction book about this woman, Ruth Payne, who was involved innocently in the Kennedy assassination. And what fascinated me were those moments when, you know, Ruth was down the street. She was, she'd made a kind of project of the Oswalds. Lee and Marine Oswald was helping them out in the months before the assassination. And that morning when, you know, a housewife in a shirtwaist dress, she goes down and has coffee with a couple of neighbors and talks about how this fellow, Lee Oswald, is looking for a job. And Linnie Mae Randall says to her, well, you know, they're hiring at the school book depository downtown. That's where my brother works. And that was how he got the job. And, you know, to me, that has a lot to do with how history happens. And also just people's characters, their foibles, their passions, whatever. And I think you have to like the people that you write about. I think any character that you inhabit as a POV character, as we say in the lit biz, you know, from the inside out, you know, what's the French proverb? To comprendre, c'est tout pardonner. To understand everything is to forgive everything. I mean, even writing John Wilkes Booth from the inside out, you know, you have to be able to say, you know, God, that leg, I bet it really hurt, you know, when he's riding away from the assassinations. And that I would say is a big difference, though, I sort of saved my nonfiction for nonfiction, whereas Vidal made his arguments through fiction. I don't think my books have any arguments. They may have an argument about, in the sense of this person was really like that, but I don't think I have any arguments to make about great historical movements or trends.
Can we switch topics and talk a little bit about the research you do? Because it seems to me that it's clear to me that the research you did for the historical novels was of a particular order, and it seems to me that it's what you might do for these novels, these last two novels, is different. I'd love to hear you talk about it because you know some of the people you're writing about. At the same time, you're feeling that you want to know more about them than you might know on an anecdotal level,
yeah,
or you know, having read accounts of the newspaper. And I'm sort of like, you know, how did you research Nixon during that, you know, while he's in that period where Watergate is unfolding?
Well, at Watergate, I had a kind of surfeit of source material. I mean, there were the tapes. Oh my God. I missed the tapes. I mean, what I wanted with Reagan were tapes. And of course, I didn't have any tapes because Nixon had put an end to that. There are never going to be presidential tapes. again, but I, you know, I fell back. Reagan did keep a diary quite regularly. It's not very reflective, but he does record things in it. And he was on the phone a lot with Nixon, and the calls were initiated from both of them. And I would have given anything to have tapes of Nixon and Reagan on the phone. But I had to imagine it from, you know, Reagan's diary. I know that they talked to each other before Reagan went to China in 1984. And you can imagine Nixon's part of the conversation. You know, the geopolitical chess player, Ron, you gotta tell him to keep those divisions in Manchuria on the Soviet border. You gotta tell him to float the currency, blah, 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 all of this. And all we know of the conversation, because there are no tapes, is Reagan's diary, where he said, got some great advice from the China trip. He said, when you go to the banquets and they pass around the food, just take whatever it is and swallow. Don't ask what it is. And I mean, in Watergate, there were tapes, there were committee transcripts, there were transcripts of judicial proceedings. Everybody wrote a memoir just to pay their legal bills sometimes. The Reagan figures, they all wrote their memoirs as well, and there was
plenty. But take someone like Pamela Harriman.
Pamela Harriman had a great, this is the, you know, doyen of the Democratic Party, Pamela Digby Churchill Hayward Harriman, who in the book has just become Avril Harriman's widow and has gotten his $100 million plus the $30 million Van Gogh White Roses portrait that Carter Brown, her walker, is trying to get for the National Gallery. And Pamela, who, I mean, there was a, and between the husbands, I mean, a cast of thousands, from Johnny Agnelli to Elida Rothschild, I mean, everybody. And so she is determined to make herself into a political power player. So she founds, she and Avril Harriman together founded this political PAC, which was known as PAM PAC in her widowhood. And it is tremendously important in the Democrats' recapture of the Senate in 1986. And she is determined to have her reward, which she eventually gets from Bill Clinton, the next Democratic president, who makes her the ambassador to France, where she dies a very Pamela-like death, swimming in the pool at the Ritz. You know, she's an incredible combination of genuine English aristocracy. I mean, she's Lord Digby's daughter, and you know, there were at times 15 different Digbys in Parliament, whatever. But she has this reputation. In the 50s, she becomes a kind of courtesan, and so she's this strange amalgam of royalty and Nell Gwynn, you know, at the same time. And one of the things she's doing in the from the 50s on is trying to make herself financially secure and to regain respectability. And that's what the last part of her life is. And I mean, it's very odd when you consider her background. She was super respectable. But in any case, she wanted to cut a figure of her own, and she did not lack for a sense of significance, her own significance. And she left her papers to the Library of Congress, and there are 500 boxes of them. And most of them are uncatalogued, because there are more pressing collections to catalog. But I had it in there. And Jeff Flannery said, I can find stuff roughly from that period, and you can read around in it. And so it was everything. It was all of these boring ghost-written position papers that she would pass out to politicians, and at the same time you'd find her, you know, appointment cards to get her hair cut by Kenneth up in New York, and you know, she would fly up to New York to have Kenneth do her hair, and then she would meet with a couple of people, and she would, everything to do with herself, every party favor, everything would be in those boxes, even books of matches. I remember bringing the tray with a box of documents back to the librarian, and I'm thinking, should I have told him that there are matches? This is not a great idea for a library. Well, there's safety matches, but you root around people's stuff.
All right,
then you can really find things.
And the one other person I want you to talk about from Finale is Hitch, is Christopher Hitchens.
Yes.
And how he sprung to mind as a point of view in this book.
Hitchens, if any of you have read Watergate, Hitchens is really the Alice Roosevelt Longworth he's her equivalent, I mean, in this book. In that he comments on everything, and unlike Alice, who's cracking 90 in Watergate, he's endlessly deployable as a journalist. He's very betwixt in between. I didn't know Christopher until well into the 1990s, and we became good friends in Washington. And I absolutely loved Christopher. I took his death very hard, and I constantly the two people I always want to know whenever anything happens in the news. I always wish if Hitchens were here to tell me what he thought of it, and if Nixon.
That Hitchens is a similar figure to Nixon in his contradictoriness, his conflictedness.
Absolutely. And at this point in his life, when I didn't know him, but he's in this book, he's in his mid to late 30s, he's coming out of his first marriage, he doesn't know whether to stay in the States or go back to England, he doesn't know whether he wants to keep making his career in the political pages of magazines like The Nation or throw in with the Mammon of Vanity Fair. So he's always betwixt in between. And I have him chasing Pamela Harriman to do a profile for Vanity Fair, which he never did. I have him going to Reykjavik, which he never did. But it's the kind of thing where people say, well, what will you change and what won't you change? I won't have the President of the United States in a place that he wasn't on a given day. But the kind of thing that the reader won't know is fiction unless the reader looks it up. That I'm willing to do, you know? I mean, Hitchens certainly could have been at Reykjavik. And so with Hitchens, he's the only person I ever knew well that I made a character under his own name. I mean, in an early novel of mine, there is a portrait of Mary McCarthy in a little book of mine called Aurora 7. She's a novelist called Elizabeth Wheatley. I don't know what I was thinking. She would have loathed this. And she died shortly before the book came out. And I, in that sense, I was off the hook. But with Hitchens, I put him in as himself under his own name. And I took things I heard him say, expressions he would use, and, you know, put them into his mouth at other occasions. I mean, he would say things that nobody else would say. And I mean, I remember being out one night after some reading. It was an Atlantic Monthly event. But then we all went out for dinner afterwards, and we were talking about the Iraq War, inevitably, because that was his great political apostasy. He remained a committed socialist Marxist in most respects, but he was ferociously for the war in Iraq and lost a lot of his friends over it. And I remember a conversation was about Iraq, and a woman who was a journalist, I can't even remember her name, was at the table, and she said, not in a hostile way about his position, but she said, oh, I don't want to talk about that, whatever facet of the topic it was. Oh, I don't want to talk about that. She wanted to say that. And Hitchens looks at her, and in that, you know, wonderful baritone, he says, oh, he says, well, I'm sorry that didn't hit your G-spot. And I did it, you know, like a spit take. Who says that? Nobody says those things. There's not any more that can say those things. And so I knew enough of how Christopher spoke and how he thought that when I was writing this book, if you gave me 15 minutes, I could sometimes come up with a line half as funny as he might have come up with in 15 seconds, you know, right at the dinner table. And so he was an absolute gift to me as a novelist. And he also, as you said, he was bifurcated, you know, politically. When I knew him, he was so fascinating because he was so split. When I would see him, he was very, one of the things people don't understand about Christopher, I think, is how gentle he was. He was with the exception of Mary McCarthy, he was the single most terrifyingly brilliant person I've known in life. But he was extremely sweet and seductive and gentle and incredibly helpful to young writers. And at his apartment, there were always these gaggles of people who, from different phases of his life, and he gave the only good parties in Washington. It's not a very entertaining town. It has certain stimulating things, but it's not fun socially. Hitchens parties were fun because you would meet people at loggerheads all the time. And he had these flocks of very young conservative journalists around him in the 90s. They were thrilled to have him on their side. We've got this blue chip intellectual supporting the Iraq war. He's even British, for Christ's sake. You know, he sounds great. And you'd be around them and they'd be looking at him like this. And I wrote about this in, I did an introduction. Somebody with a very odd sense of humor had me do the introduction for the reissue of his book on Mother Teresa. And they'd be, you know, let's do something counterintuitive and we'll have this nice lapscap. And I describe what I used to call the Mother Teresa moment, where they would, these, you know, kids would all be nodding at him, and then the conversation would shift away from Iraq, and he would, you know, Mother Teresa might come up, and he would say, oh yes, that thieving Albanian dwarf. And they, you know, they would have to deal with that. Because again, he was both of those things. And so it's strange to draw on recollection. Although I had to research him a lot for this book because I had to go back and see what he was writing, you know, in the 80s. And I mean, he was second to nobody in his contempt for Ronald Reagan, and that survived all through the George W. Bush years. He never relented, never changed his mind about Reagan whatsoever. And then, I mean, the other kind of research is that odd immersive research where you just, you're not looking for anything specific, but you just have to read as much, less about the period. Try to eliminate the middleman, whatever period you're dealing with in historical fiction, read more from the period so you know how people actually spoke, thought, whatever. And then the stuff like, I could not write 70 pages about that summit without going to Iceland. I had to go to that house. So I took myself to Iceland. I made sure I went the same weekend that Reagan and Gorbachev were there, the second weekend in October, so that the light would be the same, the temperatures would be the same. And got to know that house very well. You know, stayed in the hotel where the arms controllers stayed, and just wandered around, wishing I was writing one of those best-selling Scandinavian mystery novels. You know, because it looked so much like Scandinavia, and that, you know, I don't know what the I don't at all have a mystical sense of writing. I view myself as a working writer, but there is that dimension to writing where you just have to soak certain things up. I mean, I remember when I talked my way into Ruth Payne's old house, they didn't want to let me in, and I said, I just need to spend some time in this garage where the gun was. And he was a very nice man who let me into the house, and he sort of said, okay, but he didn't really understand what I was saying, and I didn't understand, I couldn't really explain it to him, but I have to be here in this house, and you know, I wasn't doing a seance or anything, but I felt the need for that, and the next day I awoke up in my hotel room in Dallas, and I was so wrought from this. As you will remember, there was nothing relaxed about that book. oh God, I still have an unlisted telephone number because I.
Well, just because of what surrounds that whole event.
Oh, I know. I used to, you know, yours were, you go to bookstores, you do readings, and oh God, there's only a handful of people, and half of them are blood relatives, you know. Oh God, you know, book touring is, and there were always every seat taken, you know, great. And then we'd go out, and I would stand up at the podium, and I realized that 80% of the people in the audience were glaring and just waiting for the question and answer session to accuse me of being a CIA But after that time in the garage and in the house, I woke up the next morning. I couldn't move. My muscles were absolutely locked and frozen from my jawline, you know, through my shoulders. And I managed like Frankenstein to get down to the front desk and said, I think I need to go to an emergency room. And the woman put me in a cab, and the next thing I was at the emergency room at Parkland Hospital, where you know, both Kennedy and Oswald had died,
this was an event you had not counted on, right?
And you know what? And I didn't. I
I actually, because there was a kind of first person, there were first person portions that book, and I actually thought of putting it in, but I didn't. And I told it to some interviewer later.
Okay.